if we all have a purpose to pay off our karma, why is the ego present? Ego is the only one that pays off the karma. If there's no ego, there's no karma. Ego creates karma, ego pays off karma. What is ego? Ego, I-ness. I am going to do this. I want to do this. It's all I, me, mine. When we are separating ourselves, the biggest thing ego does is to separate itself from all others. Whereas there's no real separation, but the ego separates. And by separation, it creates karma. If there was no separation, there would be no karma. So that is why ego creates karma, ego pays off karma. The true spiritual realization comes when you find there is no such thing as separation, and we are coming from the same source, and we are the source. Just have to discover it inside ourselves. So that is why the ego is the problem. And karma is all based on ego. It is all designed in such a way that ego only operates in three levels. The physical level, astral level, causal mental level. There's no ego beyond that. Even when you are souls, there's no ego. The soul's experience is totally different. It's like oneness. And there's no difference. We separate ourselves, so we create ego.
How to eliminate the past from the mind to make space for the present moment to live a full life.
How to eliminate the past from the mind to make space for the present moment to live a full life. Don't think of the past. We always think of the past. It's not necessary. By trying to remember the past, it does not take care of the past at all. You cannot change it. What happens is that there are some events of the past which have caused us problems. The most virulent problem from the past is something we have done wrong and we carry a sense of guilt. Guilt is the most weakening thing that we can have. When we feel guilty about something, we live in the past. We continuously remember that and can do nothing about it. It is much better that we think of the future, and the only function of the past should be to take a lesson for the future, not remembering it. You've done it, remembered it, now move forward and only think of the future. Even if you have to fantasize, what my future can be great. I can be very loving and compassionate. I could be living a very different life. Maybe all mind thinking of the future may be just a fantasy. It's better than continuously thinking of the past. Oh, I shouldn't have done that. Why did I do that? And that is why we live in the past. Living in the past stops our progress in this physical world, stops our progress in the spiritual world. So therefore, one should replace those thoughts by new thoughts of the future, hopes. Hope is always something built out in us to go to the future. A poet said, "Hope springs eternal in the human breast. Man never is, but always to be blessed." We never have any blessings. We are always going to be blessed, and that means hope. Hope creates that blessing of the future. And that is why hoping for things to happen in the future and thinking of the future is the best thing to do. Going back to the past doesn't help us at all.
This question is, how are you?
How are you? That's called an unspoken answer.
This might be repetition. This next question is, how can you know about your past? By Amira, age 7.
How can you know about your past? we cannot know much of the past, thank God for that. It's not a great thing to know about the past. People want to know about their past lives, and I always say, if you have a glimpse of the past life, make a very selective glimpse of the good things. If you look at the bad things you have done, again you will be afflicted by the guilt, which is a big negative thing that holds us back, both growth in this physical world and in the spiritual world. Therefore, don't think of the past. It's not necessary. It's over. Why are you trying to find the past? But there's a curiosity in us to look at the past. So if you want to be curious about it, go to nice gypsies. They will tell you how you were great queens and kings in the past. You do wonderful things, wonderful stories they will make. And if you like those stories, you can hear them. But don't try to go into your real past.
How are masters given the power to initiate seekers?
How are masters given the power to initiate seekers? It's a part of their destiny. Just like we all have a destiny to do various things, masters are ordinary human beings who come with a destiny that they have to help other people. And in actual formal way here, while we are here, a master always gives credit to his own master and says his own master is doing the work and he's not doing any work himself. So the credit is given to the master who asks his disciple to initiate and do work.
How can you meditate for many weeks? Dalia, age 9.
How can you meditate for many weeks? We can't meditate for half an hour. People have a big problem meditating for a long time. When we sit and gossip with each other, or play games and we are doing something, our legs never hurt. Our feet are not tired. When we meditate, legs are hurting. Our feet are tired and head is aching. These are all obstructions that the mind creates to prevent us from going away from the mind. It's this mind's way of protecting itself. Look, they're leaving me behind, they're giving me up. I was the master all this time, the mind says. I am the master, and now the master has been given up, and the real master is coming up to use me and bring me back to my old position, which was a slave. We were given the mind as a servant and a slave to work for us. What was the purpose? Here is a machine, a mind, given to us to think, to reason, to make sense, out of sense perceptions available, make sense of them, make a life. It is a great thing to use the mind. Use the mind when you want to think. But what has happened is, we are not using the mind is using us. The mind has become our master. And that is why it's very important to do meditation. In the beginning, the mind will create every obstruction possible. Thoughts will come which have never come otherwise. If you can't sleep, try to meditate, you'll get sleep also. If you have lost your keys, mind will find them out for you at that time. Other times you can't find. It will do everything possible to prevent you from going beyond it. And that is why the mind fights. And meditation, when we say we meditate for weeks, it only means you give a regular time every day to meditation. When we got initiated, when I got initiated, the great master said, even if we give 1/10 of our time to spiritual practice in this physical world where we have so many obligations created by our own destiny, it's worthwhile. Out of 24 hours, 1/10 makes about 2.5 hours. If we can give 2.5 hours, just like we give tithes, 1/10 of our net income, we give as charity, we give 1/10 of our time to a spiritual practice, it's good enough, 2.5 hours. Then somebody asked him, Master, is 2.5 hours enough? Another occasion, he said, no, not at all. How can you give 21.5 hours to something else and 2.5 hours to meditation and expect any results? So, Master, how long should we meditate? He said, at least 21.5 hours. And said, Master, how can you do that? He says, simple way. And he taught us simple way to meditate 21.5 hours. He said, first understand what is meditation. Meditation is to meditate upon something, to think about something, to remember something all the time. If you are remembering your master, it's like meditation. If you are remembering God, it's like meditation. When you are remembering anything other than this physical world, you're meditating. So that is why you can keep that thought. If you cannot keep that thought, remember a prayer. Remember to do your meditation in mantras, simran, words repeated, given by a master. When you do that, it is like meditation, not necessarily sitting formally with eyes closed and all. You can do while walking, cooking, doing other jobs. He said, why I said 21.5 hours and not 24 hours was because for most lives, the way we live, we do sometimes need to put our whole attention on a worldly activity, on some business proposition, something we are doing which requires real attention. So that's why I'm allowing 2.5 hours for that. Rest of the time can be meditation. If you practice repeating holy words, you can make it a habit. The mind picks up habits. You keep on repeating the same thing, mind picks up a habit and begin to repeat it automatically. So you wake up in the middle of the night, the mind is repeating those words. So all the night can become meditation, repeating those words. So you can make most of the day, all night, meditation, and only sometime when you need to give special attention to something, 2.5 hours is good enough for that. That's 21.5 hours is meditation. So that is why it's a way. Meditation is not merely a particular yogic practice. Meditation is a way of life, to be able to so absorbed in something. And that is why eventually, people who are following perfect living masters and experience their love, they want to spend more time with the master. They try in every opportunity to go to the master. And all the time they're thinking of the master, they're meditating all the time. And that is what is meant by real meditation. Forced meditation does not give us anything. But the pull of the love of a master helps us a lot in meditating or remembering the master all the time. So that is why don't take meditation only in the sense of a particular spiritual practice done in a yogic fashion. Meditation to remember the master. And that can be done not for a few weeks, for a whole lifetime it can be done.
Dear beloved master, will you please share with us the meaning behind the story of Krishna and the gopis?
Will you please share with us the meaning of behind the story of Krishna and the gopis? Krishna is considered the avatar, and that is, avatar means that he has come from an astral plane or a causal plane, wherever plane he came from, onto this world. He came to express love of every kind. He came to express that an ordinary person can be as spiritual as the most spiritual sage or saint that has achieved anything. His purpose was to open to the whole world how an ordinary person can become spiritual. And should never worry, oh, my life is so bad, I've done so many bad deeds, how can I be on a spiritual path? He came to destroy that idea. And therefore, he was born like an ordinary person. And he grew up in a family in India, in Uttar Pradesh, in a small little village, where he was tending to cows of the village. His friend was there, one very close friend, Udo, and he both used to go. They were young boys, and they took care of the cows of the village. They used to share stories themselves, and they were bringing the cows back at home. Now, during that period, Krishna was still young, but since he was the incarnation of Vishnu, now you have to remember that there are three gods, Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva. Brahma is the creator, Vishnu sustainer, Shiva the destroyer. These three gods are really representing the nature of time, which has a beginning, middle, and end. Everything that we experience in life has a beginning, middle, and end. So this beginning, middle, and end in religious language has been called Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva. So you could also translate to English beginning, middle, and end. So these three are functions of time. So Brahma does a work for one time, creates, and then he rests. Vishnu takes over the middle part. Shiva comes one time, ends. So the main function of sustaining life as it is in our lives or life of anybody is the middle part, after birth till death. Birth Brahma, death Shiva, the rest of the life is Krishna. Therefore, Vishnu has been represented that out of three gods as the one who has to maintain this universe and comes from time to time as an avatar. So this avatar concept does not include only human beings. When there were no human beings and there were other forms of life, Krishna came in that form, Vishnu came in that form also. They say there are 10 forms in which Vishnu has come as an avatar. The first form is as a fish. This whole planet of ours, where he appeared, was all covered in the water. There was no other form of life except in the water. And he appeared in the same form. Were there human beings at that time? There's another big question in spiritual tradition. What is the definition of a human being? Is it the form of the body that makes a human being or something else? What is the difference between a human being and other forms of life? There are so many other forms of life. According to one list in the Indian scriptures, there are as many as 8.4 million forms of life. And every form of life has the same soul creating life in that form. Whether it's an insect, or whether it's a bird, or it's an angel sitting up in heaven, all life forms are in that list of 8.4 million. And human being is only one out of that. All other forms of life are living according to a programmed destiny for which they come. All other forms of life go with the flow. Only one form of life defies that. It says, I'll make my own plans, I make my own destiny while I'm playing out the destiny with which I am born. And that's a human form. The reason for that is that this particular feature of human life gives us a feeling of having a free will. Free will is a very discussed subject. For thousands of years it has been discussed. Whether we have truly a free will or everything is predetermined. If everything is predetermined, how can we be punished for our karma? If we don't make any decisions here, it's all already made somewhere else, how can we be subject to the law of karma? And if we have free will, then there's another problem. If we truly have a power to make a decision, what we'll do tomorrow morning, and nobody knows it, if somebody else knows it, it's not free. But if nobody knows it, not even God knows it, then the definition of God has to be changed. Because God is supposed to be not only omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent. Omniscient means he knows everything. A decision we are going to make tomorrow is known to God today. So therefore, on the basis of this assumption that God knows everything, we can't have free will, yet we make decisions every day. What is the truth about this free will? And that's a very big question, because only one form of life, human life, has free will, which means they make a decision for themselves, make their own destiny while they're living here. So the real secret of that is to be found in the fact that our minds, when our destiny is made up, the way our minds will think and make decisions are pre-programmed. I'll tell you a particular interesting fact. When I was studying in the university here, there was a friend of mine who was also trying to study whether the concept of free will is an illusion or reality, whether we really have free will or we don't. So one day he called me early morning and he said, "Eureka, I found out we have no free will. It's all predetermined." I said, "Are you sure?" He said, "Yes, I'm sure. I found out on theological basis and other basis." I said, "Will you come over to my house and we'll discuss it further?" So while he was coming to my house, I thought of playing a little trick on him. So I, on a tray, put up a cup of tea, a cup of coffee, and an empty cup. When he arrived, I said, "You have no free will. Tell me, would you like to have coffee, tea, or nothing? I got all three ready. And don't use free will, you don't have any." And he was stumped. He said, "All my discovery has been destroyed by three cups." I had just found out that it is inconsistent for a human being to have free will if there's an omniscient God. And we believe in that omniscience of God, of a creative power. And that is why the two things don't match, so I say we know free will. I have just demonstrated to you that you have free will. Not only you have free will, I am binding you down to free will. If you say, "I don't want to take anything," free will. "I'll take this," free will. Whatever you will speak now is use of your free will. How can you escape it? You are exercising your free will. And I tell you, we exercise our free will several times during a day. Small, small decisions we make. Do this or not do this. We are using it all the time. A genuine experience of free will, of free selection, of our choices. Our life is full of choices. And we have to make a choice. Sometimes we have to make such difficult choices, we don't know which way to go. And still we have to make it. How can you deny free will? So he said, "You destroyed all my great knowledge." I said, "Don't worry, I'll not speak in favor of your knowledge. I'll tell you how free will works. And I'll tell you on a scientific basis. Not on the basis of what the scripture says. Pure scientific, psychology, the human psychology, I will explain from that point of view." And I said, "When you choose something, what makes you choose? What happens in your head when you're making a choice? For example, I gave you tea and coffee to choose. And you, after a little while, said, 'I'll take coffee.' And you're drinking coffee now. What made you choose coffee? What went into your head to exercise that power of free will that led you to take coffee? If you analyze carefully, only two factors. One, hereditary. Your father liked coffee, grandfather liked coffee, great-grandfather liked coffee, it's in your genes. Genetic tendencies could create your feeling you like coffee. You don't know the whole history. Your genes are carrying that and liking for coffee. Genetic, which means inherited. Second, acquired. You might have been living with people who drank coffee. You got knowing about the taste of coffee. You got a taste acquired by company of people. At the moment when I ask this question, these two factors, the only two factors that made you decide coffee, were fixed already. You couldn't change them. You just didn't know how the mind is functioning. And therefore you thought that you're deciding it now. The fact is that the factors that make us make choices are not only pre-programmed, we have lived through them. And that is why it looks like free will, it's not free will. Then of course, if it is not free will, looks like free will, it's an illusion, What about the law of karma operating then? Well, let me tell you, the law of karma is as much illusion as the illusion of free will. There's no difference between the two. So long as we feel we have free will, karma operates. When we rise above it, there's no karma at all. The whole show becomes a predetermined movie we are watching. So it's only our level of experience here that gives us both the feeling of free will and the feeling that we can decide our future and yet have to pay our karma. Both linked together. Both same level of illusion. It's not that one is higher than lower. Both created at the causal level. Both created at the mental level. So that is why the truth is that this feeling of free will has been created, and the cause of it, which is hidden in our head, is hidden from us. So it looks like it's real free will. Karma looks real the same way. Like it's we are suffering karma. We are creating karma. Not at all. It's pre-programmed. Karma is pre-programmed like free will. Having understood that much, then the question is that what is the benefit of this? That only a human being has it and nobody else has this. No other species of form of life is ever bothered about it. Only we are bothered about making decisions. Their decisions are made by the environment, by the genetic tendencies, by the programming of their instincts. They all act like that. What is the special benefit to a human being? Benefit is this illusion and practical, real free will is the only thing required to give us a feeling we are seekers of the truth. You would not become seekers if this feeling was not there. So it's a gift. It's a gift of ignorance. Supposing we knew what is going to happen in the next 5 minutes, we lose our free will right here. Supposing we knew what's happening next week, our free will go. Sometime there are people who come and can tell us what's going to happen next week. There was a lady in DeKalb. I met her at a Spiritual Frontiers Fellowship meeting, and she was able to hold somebody's hand and tell what will happen next week. A born gift she had. So she decided to come and see me in Chicago. So she lived about 40 miles away. So I said, I had just come from India, was working in a poor, small little company, trying to make both ends meet. And I said, you can meet me. I'll tell my boss to let you meet me in his office, small little office I have in a small section of Chicago. 1 week before she came, she had that vision, which she used to have from time to time. She had a vision. She's come to see me in a hotel, 5-star hotel, not in the office. And a huge stretch limousine, a black stretch limousine has come, and I've come out of that to see her. She said, that's not possible. I recorded. She had a journal in which she recorded all the dreams and visions that she used to get. So she recorded that. And after 1 week, she came. As it happened, during that week, our business made good money, and the company decided to buy a large stretch limousine. And they bought the kind of limousine which she saw in the vision. And we changed the location of the meeting at the last moment to a 5-star hotel in Chicago. And she was surprised when she got information to meet at a different place. When she was waiting there, the limousine came. I stepped out of it and she opened the journal. I wrote this 1 week ago. So she could see exactly what's going to happen a week ago in that detail. So it can't happen unless it's already happened. Now, if you were to meditate deeply enough to go merely up to the causal plane of the mind, you will discover the creation of time and space there. And you will discover something very interesting. What you will discover, which scientists are today discovering in science, you will discover that time is a flat line of events. Nothing is moving. Time never moves. Time is merely a line on which events have been placed. And you are moving on those events, going from one event to another. Looks like time is moving through us. Actually, we are moving. Our attention is moving through those events, pre-programmed and made part of our mind. And that is why it looks like we are now waiting for tomorrow. Tomorrow is already there. The day after is already there. 1,000 years ahead are already there. But it looks like it's a future, and we can actually go into that future. That is what our concept of time is, that we are waiting for tomorrow to come. It's already there. We have to move there, which we are moving through our consciousness inside. A very interesting thing, and I want to tell you a little bit more for some of you who are very keen to understand the nature of time. Time is not what we think it is. We have divided time for our convenience into three parts: past, present, and future. We live in the present. We don't live in the past, it's a memory. We don't live in the future, still to come. Where do we live? We live in the present. The present is called now. N-O-W. Why am I repeating the word now? Because books have been written telling us live in the now. And I don't know a single person in the world who doesn't live in the now. We are all living only in the now, the present. And think deeply, now has no time at all. Not even a nanosecond. The moment I say nanoseconds passed, before that it was future. Now has no time. Can you believe that we are not living in any time at all? Because we're only living in the now, and now has no time. And how are we feeling there is time? How can we feel we are living in time when the only time to live in is now, which has no time? So there's a secret for that. The secret is that we are experiencing recent past, which we call now. The few seconds, few minutes that have just passed, is I'm talking to you now. It just, these words came, and that was past. A little past we are calling present. Little past we are calling now. Okay, if now and present is past, what about future? Is there a future also? Let's examine that too. Supposing we stop hoping, fearing, anticipating mental activities. We hope for something, we are afraid of something, we anticipate something. Supposing these three words disappear from our dictionaries and our life, no future. You're creating a future with these three functions of the mind. And each of these three functions takes time, and therefore they're in the past. Can you imagine what we have been calling past, present, and future is all past? And just very carefully examine this. It's a very strange way to look at life, but it's true that we are calling a past as present and future. If it is past, nobody can experience the past. It's already gone. Then what are we experiencing? Past has gone, now has no time, future is just being created by the past. How are we experiencing it? There's only one way to experience the past, and that is called memory, recall. This is a recall. We are actually recalling because through memory, and this looks like real life. Why I'm telling you all this is, if you were to go to deep meditation and go into the causal plane, you will see how destinies are merely capsules of memories. I sometimes call them DVDs, that you're picking up a DVD and it's play out here in this physical time and looks like past, present, future all exist. And we are just playing out a memory, but playing out with that kind of a sensory perception where the persistence of the event keeps it moving like it's real. Like movies. If you see a movie, an actor is acting on the screen, but the cause of that acting is merely still pictures moving at a certain rate quickly. The persistence of vision, if you move less than 16 seconds a frame, you will never see a person moving. There will be flashes of still pictures. You move it faster, the eyes can then be confused. An optical illusion can be created. There's actual movement taking place. This, the mind's ability of persistence of vision is a million times more. Therefore, it looks like a smooth movement of life. It's a very big discovery, how life is being arranged, how it's being created here. But that you can actually find if you go to the causal plane and discover how destinies are made. Now, if you pick up a destiny there and come here, and that destiny contains your karma, destiny contains your ups and downs of life, you can't say, who put this karma on me? You brought it with you. So you're still responsible, you still made your own choices, but at a different level. You don't make choices here, you make choice there. It's a very interesting experience, but it is not easy to verify it except by going within to that level of the mind and by rising above the level of the physical self and the astral self, the sensory self. Then only you can see these things. But very interesting to understand the nature of time. Now, Krishna and gopis, that's where we started. Krishna, I diverted so much, went away. I folded the question, you know. Krishna came as avatar of Vishnu, the central part of time, to make sustenance. He was ordinary person and did a lot of mischievous things. If he were born today, he would be in jail. I can tell you. He told more lies than anybody did. Starting from his childhood, he loved to eat butter, and the mother didn't want him to become fat and wanted to hide the butter, and she would hide the butter by hanging it on a string on top. He'd bring his friends, climb on top of them and eat the butter. And his mother said, have you again eaten the butter? His mouth is all full of butter. He says, no, mom, I never ate butter. And can you imagine these words, mother, I never ate butter, is a great spiritual song today, praising that Krishna. Maya mori manai makhan khayo. Mother, I never ate butter at all. And the mother laughs when she sees all the butter is all in his face. So he started his life by lying. Then he started his life by having too many girlfriends. They are called gopis. Those girls used to be wandering about in the village, and he was taking care of the cows. And then the girls would come, he would play games with them. Not all the games have been mentioned in the scriptures, but some things like hiding their clothes while they are having a bath in the pond are mentioned. Things like that. And then, in spite of all the gopis, he falls in love publicly with the wife of another man, who beats the wife down and sends him down, and that wife is also today worshipped as Radha. If you look at the history of the man, that he led a most ordinary life to guarantee to us we are all sinners in a way that he was, in terms of the moral society, morals laid down by society, and yet he could hold his consciousness at the highest level and treat this as a play. And they, in the scripture, they call it Leela. That's his Leela. That's his play. It's our play too. He came to set an example for us. Take this as the play. It's no more than that. And the gopis and those were made in the characters of this play. He made those gopis so much fond of him. Jealousy free. Today, if the gopis are there, these will be jealous of each other. But they were shown as gopis, as girls who were jealousy free. Another example. They're all examples for us. So in one song, one man sang in Chicago. There's a beautiful song and tells the story that when Krishna went away on some errand with his best friend, Udo, he said to Udo, the gopis might be waiting for me to see me, and I haven't had a chance to teach them true meditation. Why don't you go and teach them meditation like I teach people? Close your eyes, go within, you can see everything. So Udo went back to talk to the gopis. And the gopis saw Udo coming. Udo, tell us, how is Krishna? How is he doing? How is his health? He said, I have come from Krishna to teach you meditation. Sit here, close your eyes and meditate. And the gopi said, we will not close our eyes. Krishna might be hiding somewhere and he might just come. We don't want to miss seeing him. And this is the refrain of the song. We will not close our eyes. Krishna might come and we will miss seeing him. showing the intense love and devotion of the gopis for Krishna. So there are so many stories to show the examples he set, that we are ordinary people, he is an ordinary person, he is like us, and yet he can be so advanced in his consciousness that he can give a great discourse to a prince, Arjun, on the battlefield. In the battlefield of between Kauravas and Pandavas, the battlefield, he stops the chariot. He is a chauffeur. Imagine a chauffeur of a chariot is giving a talk to the owner of the chariot, the prince. He stops, turns around, because the chariot is with the horses and not the steering wheel. But it could be a steering wheel too, would be the same thing. So he is telling him, this is all a play. If you want to understand it's a play, you have to go beyond this. Three ways of going. He explained there. Three ways of going there. And the three ways I call that you can become a karma yogi, you can become a sankhya yogi, you can be a bhakta yogi. Yoga is union with your true self. Let me tell you all three methods. And explains to Arjun. He says, if you act with your best intention to do anything in life, with the best skill you have, the actual Sanskrit words are, for those interested, yoga karma su kaushalam, that if you can use the best skill you have to perform any action and not worry about the fruits thereof, you'll become a yogi. You'll get union with God. Because when you don't expect a result, it becomes like a service and your mind is controlled. Second way is to think and think hard. Ultimately, you Gyan Yoga, the knowledge that we get through the mind, find out the limit of the knowledge of the mind and you'll go beyond it. But he said the best way is love and devotion. Bhakti Yoga is the best. So he's giving those wonderful talks. And he's the same person who as a child had known about the law of karma. He had told Udo once as a child. Udo. And I heard this story in his place where he was born and lived. I went there to see what people think about him in the very area where he lived. And there the people sing songs in praise of him. And many of them are working in the fields and gardens. And when they get tired in the evening, they sit together, they sing. And they feel happy to remember Krishna and they sing. And the song they were singing, which I remember, the words, some of you might understand, I'll translate. Are udo karman ki gat nyari sa. He says the nature of karma is very strange. That's the refrain of the song. They keep on singing and they smoke something. I don't know if there's something in that also. But they are very happy and enjoying themselves. So I saw them. I sat with them. I sang also with them. And I realized they are referring to the story of Krishna going with Udo and pointing out to an ant crawling. And he said, Udo, you can't understand the nature of karma. Look at this little ant. Little small insect. One time this ant was Brahma, the creator. One time this very ant was Indra, which is the head of a big heaven in the astral plane. And because of his karma, he's an ant today, even after that realization. He says there is no way to atone for a bad action. Supposing you do good actions, you're rewarded. Bad actions, punished. There is no cancellation. That's the law of karma. That is why it perpetuates our stay here. Some people think, I have done some bad thing, now I'll do some good things and I'll escape. No escape. You get punished for bad things and you get rewarded for good things and nothing cancels each other. Therefore, you're trapped here forever. That's what he's explaining, how karma traps us forever. So that is why all these stories that we talk about Krishna or the gopis or his relationship with Udos, all are exemplifying that our awareness does not depend upon this show. You can be a great sinner. One of the greatest sinners would come to these masters and get saved by them. In the case of great master, Baba Sawan Singh, at one time, they had decided to build a little ashram, a dera. And they decided, the architect decided, that on the top of the little pillarets, we'll put gold domes, little gold domes. So they said, let's collect all the gold we can. People contributed their jewelry. All the ladies brought their own jewelry, gold jewelry, and they stored it. And one gang of thieves found that out, gang of robbers found that out. And they said, that's a good place to rob. So they sent one of their team members. He was a Muslim guy, and he was sent there to go and investigate, do a recce, reconnaissance where the gold is hiding, so we can all come and attack and loot the gold and take it. So he came, and he came at a time when the great master was giving a discourse in the evening at 5 o'clock. So he went around in the different houses of the dera, and he asked them, why are you not attending the meeting? So we are taking care of the gold. Where is the gold in that box? He said, this is the easiest reconnaissance I've ever done. The children are there. Why are you playing here in this courtyard? We are protecting the gold which is being collected. He saw several houses where the ladies of the houses who hadn't gone to the discourse or the children were telling exactly where the gold is. He said, what kind of man is he? He can give a talk and people don't care even for their gold and even for their wealth. Let me go and see. What is he saying? So after finishing all his study, he came and stood at the back. As he stood back, Great Master was discoursing at that time, a small crowd. And Great Master said, that power, that gift power of sound that takes us above, rings true in every human being, including robbers and dacoits. He got alarmed. How did he know about that I am here? So he stayed on. When the discourse ended, he went up to Great Master. He said, Master, I just heard you recognize me. You said that power is inside robbers also. How did you know I am a robber? Great Master said, I don't know you at all. I don't know who you are. You just said that even robbers and dacoits have that kind of power inside. He said, I say that every day. There's nothing great for me to say. He said, no, don't tell me that. I know it was directed to me. I know you were looking at me when you said that. Great Master said, I just glanced around anyway. Might have fallen my eyes on you at that time. Anyway, he said, I am going to find out more about that power. He decided to quit his gang. And he said, Great Master, I'm going to stay here. He said, what will you do here? In the dera, everybody is working. What will you do? He said, I don't know what I'll do. He said, what do you know? He said, I only know how to rob people. Great Master said, you can't be robbing people here. But if you want to stay, you have to do something. Tell me, when you used to do, the gang used to rob, what was your role? He said, my role was to take care of the getaway truck, the vehicle that was used, and I could repair its electrical system, the dynamo and all that. He said, very good, we'll give you work now. You set up an electric generator here. He bought a small little generator, and he worked on that and became one of the finest disciples of the great master. His name was Shadi, and he became his security mandator, traveled with him everywhere. And there's so many stories about him. And he was able to go back into the past, show his meetings with Prophet Muhammad, show his time with Jesus Christ. And he went and saw all those great names that we call that they were saviors of the world. And he was able to see them back in time by just going within. So these are examples that we have with us. How much is possible for us to know and to gather by going inside? Krishna set an example with the gopis also the same way. So I've taken a long time to answer this question. It gave me a chance to tell other stories also. Thank you very much for listening to me again. And I'll spend a little time for meeting people on a one-on-one basis who have asked for it. And those who have never seen me before, their names are placed on top of the list. I don't know if I'll have time to see all of you, but I'll certainly see all those who are coming for the first time to see me. So thank you very much for patiently listening to me, and my blessings, Great Master's blessings, be with you.